Okay, now that we have our model and it's pretty much doing what we want it to do, I want to use the model to talk about a couple of key concepts in agent-based modeling. So first of all, we did a pretty good job of going through and documenting our code as we were doing it. But one other thing you want to do is you want to probably go through and document in the info tab as well. So we're going to go over to the info tab, we can hit edit, and then we can go over and we can say, you know, under what is it, for instance, we can say this is a model of the Heroes and Cowards game from the Fratelli group, right? And, you know, we could go ahead and fill in a lot of these other sections. Now, one thing that I find very valuable as a model coder, as a model programmer, as I'm building my model, is to actually write out kind of early on a what's called a pseudocode description of the way the model works. And I usually do this under the how it works section because it'll eventually morph into that. You might also want to save this off in a separate, more technical document if you didn't want to include it in the info tab directly. But you know, I usually always talk about how there's going to be an initialize procedure, and there's going to be kind of an iterative or a tick procedure, right? And so the initialize is the setup that you know we're commonly thought of thinking of, and the iterative or the tick section is the go procedure, right? And so what do we want the model to do? And a lot, sometimes I'll even do this before I even create the model. In this case, I knew the model pretty well, so I just started writing it. But you know, we wanted to create a group of turtles, and you know, maybe in future work, and while we're extending this model, we want this to be where the number of turtles is from an input slider, right, on the interface. Now, I didn't do that in this model, but you know, maybe this is, you know, something I'm going to do in the future. We could have each turtle move to a random location on the screen, obviously. Random location. We could have, you know, and then we have to have the conditional based upon the personality. So if a, well, we could say there is a chooser called personalities that specifies the behavior. A lot of times in NetLogo code, actually, if we're talking about a variable in a pseudocode description, we'll put it in caps, right? So we might want to put setup go personalities in caps, and maybe number, which should be our number of turtles, to distinguish it from the rest of what we're writing. And then we can say if personalities equals brave, right, the turtle turns blue, and then we can kind of do the same thing for the other, for a cowardly, right, the turtle turns red, and we could do the same for mixed, right, if personalities equals mixed, then the turtle turns red or blue randomly, right? We also have to say that each turtle picks a friend and an enemy, right? And we reset the ticks, if you will, right? And so this is just like a natural language description. We can go in and we can finish this off by writing the go description, right? Each turtle, which is blue, moves, just realized I backed this up, didn't I? So this is why documentation is always important to do. So if you notice, when I was writing it, I said the turtle turns blue if it's brave, but in the code, I said that the cowards are who turns blue. So let's change that around while we're doing this, which is why it's important to make sure you're checking your code. So each turtle which is blue moves away from the enemy past the friend. And actually those are variables, so I can capitalize them, right? And then we can also do the same, say we could say each turtle, which is red, moves toward the enemy in the way of friend, something like that, and then the actual language description, right? And that's it. I mean, that's the kind of toward the enemy. That's kind of the natural language description of the model itself, right? Very easy to do. And it's a pseudocode description now that I could hand to someone else to ask them what they thought of this model. So it's important to do documentation. Make sure you're documenting the model, both in terms of a separate document as well as within the code, because it makes it easier to tell whether your conceptual model and your implemented model are matching each other. So one thing that I find very interesting about this model is that when you hit mixed, right, you never quite get the same procedures or the same results. It always looks a little different, right? And that's because NetLogo is randomly placing the turtles in the world. But what's interesting is because the computer doesn't actually have a true random notion, what it's actually doing instead is it's using a random number generator to create what we call pseudo-random numbers. Now, these numbers are actually generated usually in the deterministic process that's specified by a random seed. And what NetLogo does a lot of times is it generates a bunch of new random seeds every time it's running the model. And then it uses those seeds to actually decide what the values are to pull. But you can set the seed, just to illustrate this. So one thing I could do, for instance, is I could say the random seed equals 188, right? And then I can say show random 100. And I can do that a couple of times. And what this is doing is generating three random numbers, right? And if I set the random seed back to that same value, 188, I will then get the same three random numbers in a row. So this means that if I see a pattern of behavior and I've set the random seed, I can recreate that pattern even though it's technically a random pattern, a random outcome of what's going on. And in fact, this is often done when you're running a bunch of agent-based models, that you set the seed before you run so that if something interesting happens in the model, you can then go back and look at the results at a later time, right? And so, in fact, if you pull up the Heroes and Cowards model that is in the NetLogo models library, I'll go ahead and save that, you'll actually find, it's under the IABM textbook at the section, chapter 2, which is the chapter we're in, Heroes and Cowards. So, what we've done is we've got some preset configurations. And so what are those preset configurations doing? Well, if you look at them, they're actually running a command called preset, which has this long string over it. Well, if you look in the code, what preset actually does is take a random number seed and set the random number seed to that value. And in fact, it also has to set the number of agents to a specific value, because if the number of agents is different, then you'll get a different number of calls. So what does this allow us to do? Well, it means that when we hit one of these buttons, right, one of these preset configurations, we will always get the same pattern. So here we're going to hit this, the dot pattern, and if we let it run, you'll see that eventually we get down to a spinning dot, right? And that's a kind of a common pattern that we see. If we hit the frozen button and then let it run, you'll see we get to this stage, which is kind of interesting, where a bunch of the turtles are just frozen in the middle of the world. And then one of my favorites is the slinky pattern, right? Which causes this slinky that just bounces from edge to edge. The spiral pattern, which creates this like spiral effect in the middle, right? And you can get other slinkies and yo-yos and the wandering flock pattern, we call it. And the generally cool one that does some interesting things and eventually stops. We didn't have a short name for that one. Anyways, so, you know, this illustrates a powerful both problem and benefit of the NetLogo world, which is that in agent-based modeling, which is that you're going to be able to control somewhat the randomness of what goes on in it, but it's something you need to think about when you're generating your model results as to what that randomness really is. So That's it for this week, except for the wrap-up, which will come in next. You can go ahead and the test will be live shortly, and go for there. So thanks. Next week, we'll be starting on Unit 3, where we'll be talking about how to extend models other people have built.